Coming up on Harvest, how do you build and maintain healthy relationships? If I knew that, we wouldn't have three co-hosts gone today. Author and speaker Dr. Linda Mintle shares the answer in her new project, We Need to Talk. Plus, Middle East correspondent Brian Bush takes a break from the news to share moments in the Holy Land from the beautiful old city. And Pastor Mark Lantz is here to kick off his new teaching series entitled Living in the World of Supernatural Knowledge. Knowledge, knowledge. Don't go anywhere. Harvest starts now. And hi again, everybody, alongside Pastor Mark Lantz, Chuck Freebie with you on another edition of Harvest. So glad that you've been able to join us and hopefully get some information and inspiration over the next hour. And Pastor Mark, I'm sure you've been following the events in the news just like everybody else. We're all very troubled by the situation that happened in Charleston, South Carolina, almost a week ago now. Yeah. But as a pastor, I'm sure you regard the situation maybe with a little bit different eye than most of us do. What are some of the things that you're seeing coming out of Charleston, both the good and the bad?
Sure. Well, I would say the good, I see the resolve of the believers. I mean, that same church is open tonight for Bible study and prayer, which is amazing. You know, 1 week after that tragedy, they're still coming back. They're praying, studying the word together. Yeah. They're not going to let this deter them from their faith, which really is a very positive thing. And you look at the church, anytime there's any kind of persecution, the church always gets stronger. So number one, I really see the resolve of the church. Plus, I really see people coming together in a conversation about, you know, safety and about what do we have to do as a church. I know we've had that conversation in our church. Mm-hmm. How do we keep our people safe? How do we have security? So there's a lot of things that come out of this, but I think most of all, it's a resolution of our faith.
So without giving away any secrets of how you do it at Christian Center, because you know, obviously we don't want your efforts to get foiled, but what are some of the steps you do take towards securing your own church?
Sure. Well, I mean, we've got to, number one, make a safe environment for our people to come in and worship. We're there to connect with God, and we want to make sure there's no deterrent, there's nothing that's going to keep them from that connection. So we've got people that are constantly watching, you know, not only the doors, the hallways, but, you know, they're just kind of watching the congregation. They're our eyes, and they feel like this is a ministry. I mean, it's not something that they do, you know, because, well, I'm a security person. No, this is a ministry to them. They're there to protect people, and at the end of the day, really, that's what it's about, making an environment that is safe, that is healthy, for people really to connect with God.
You know, we talked about this a couple of days ago on the show, but just seeing the spiritual part of it, especially on Sunday when people came back to that church and people both black and white coming to that church and coming together. Here's a man that allegedly said that he wanted to create a race war when he did this incident. Mm-hmm. And if anything, it seems like he's galvanized the people of Charleston together.
Absolutely. And that's what should happen.
Yeah.
You know, that's the United States of America. We are one people, diverse, you know, maybe in skin color and background, but we are one people. And when this tragedy happens, it should bring us together. We should unite together, not only in prayer, but as a community of people supporting not only this church, but just the body of Christ at large. There should be a unity that comes out of this.
The funeral will begin, I believe, tomorrow in South Carolina. I know President Obama is supposed to give the eulogy at the funeral for State Senator Pinckney, who is being honored today in the Capitol in Columbia, South Carolina, where he'll have his body lying in state there as other people come by to honor him. And that's an interesting combination, too, because you've got a pastor who was involved politically. We've heard so much about that, about how the government is trying to crack down on pastors being politically active from the pulpit. But here was a guy that was doing it in the legislature. Talk about the conflict that goes on there within a life.
Well, I don't know that it should really be a conflict. I mean, you look at the founding fathers of our country. They were very religious, very faith-filled men. And I really see that our political spectrum of our country should be influenced by those who have that pastoral heart. And I think that's the way we're going to be able to see a cultural change in our country, is for men like that to not only fill the pulpit, but also to have a voice, you know, within the congressional floor. So I think it's a healthy thing. I really do. I think it's something that our country needs to see. One of the men that I looked up to when I was a young pastor was a Kentucky state senator and a pastor at the same time. And he had a voice on a lot of different platforms that made a big difference.
Well, speaking of the influence of pastors, I was looking online, and I'm sure that you probably frequent this site a lot, space.com. And they said, here was an article on how to bolster space exploration, get religious groups on board. And the article goes on to say, to broaden support for space exploration, advocates should consider approaching religious groups, especially in settings that are familiar to religion. A peer-reviewed study by the University of Dayton's Joshua Ambrosius tackles what Ambrosius calls a little-studied topic in how literature, in how religion plays into public support of space exploration. And he goes on to say, if an evangelical parishioner, by the way, they found that evangelicals as a group knew the least about space exploration. But he went on to say, if an evangelical parishioner views their pastor as speaking about science in a positive light, they're more likely to see value in space exploration. I have no present data on whether clergy speak about space from the pulpit or not. I'm assuming it's very rare. But they'd like to see more pastoral support for space exploration. Any thoughts?
Interesting. Well, I would like to explore the space in the mind of my people, first of all. That's the biggest thing. But yeah, I could. With that, I think it's a conversation about Bible and science that should come together. So in that realm, I think pastors should speak about it in the sense that science is validated by the scriptures. And scriptures really are the ones that prove that, you know what, science doesn't prove the scriptures true. Scriptures prove science to be true. So that, from that standpoint, yeah, pastors should talk about that. Space exploration, I don't talk about that a whole lot. Don't go to the site often. Don't know that I will either, but at the
same time,
I see the validity of it. Yeah.
No, it was interesting because one of the speculations that this gentleman who did the study had was, I'd like to see more speculation about what religious traditions will thrive once we achieve interplanetary travel. I believe my work on contemporary support might foreshadow which traditions will actively evangelize and minister to space colonists. I think we first of all got to take care of Earth and
evangelizing here
on Earth, and then maybe we can worry about some of the other planets as well. And that reminds me, we're in the middle of our global summer harvest right now. And if you believe evangelizing the Earth is important, if you believe taking the Word of God into other countries is important, we invite you to help us out here at LeSEA Broadcasting. We have so many campaigns that do that, our Spread the Word Bibles, Middle East Television, Shortwave Radio, and of course our 24-hour prayer line, and all of those are unfunded ministries at LeSEA Broadcasting, unfunded unless you step forward and help us out. So we invite you to call that number on your screen right now, 1-800-365-3732, or you can go online at LeSEA.com, and you can do that while you're watching The Harvest Show. Plus, you can join our conversation. Maybe you'd like to hear your pastor speak more about space exploration or maybe less about it. Well, you can like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, send your email directly to the set of harvest at LeSEA.com. Don't go anywhere. A very handsome gentleman does the international news next here on Harvest.
Pete Summerall has always shared his father's lifelong vision to save the lost. So over the summer months of June and July, LeSEA Broadcasting is praying fervently that God will bring in a bountiful global summer harvest. To sustain vital ministries that are now reaching countless millions of people, LeSEA must receive $331,000 in the next 60 days. Please send your June gift today. Call LeSEA Broadcasting at 1-800-365-3732. That's 1-800-365-3732.
Now on this Wednesday, June 24, 2015, here's what's happening in your world. Police have released the dash cam video showing the suspect in last week's shooting rampage at that Charleston church moments after his arrest. The video shows the arrest of Dylan Roof, a 21-year-old white man who told a friend he had a plan to do something for the white race and posed in photos displaying Confederate flags. The video, recorded by a dash camera in the car of a patrol car, shows four officers approaching Roof's vehicle in Shelby, North Carolina last Thursday morning, some with guns drawn. He was then frisked and handcuffed without incident. Shelby's about 250 miles from Charleston, where nine people, including the Reverend Clementa Pickney, were shot and killed the night before at Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church. Security is being increased in Dover, England, after hundreds of migrants hoping to reach England from northern France were swarming trucks caught up in traffic caused by striking ferry workers. The UK's Minister for Security and Immigration, James Brokenshire, says his country can only do so much to solve the migration problem.
We're also stepping up our response at Dover as well, but ultimately it is for the French government and French law enforcement to assure security and safety in France.
Traffic has resumed in the tunnel beneath the English Channel, but lines are still long for the trucks traveling between Britain and France. Migrants from Sudan, Eritrea, and elsewhere are camped by the thousands in the port city of Calais, trying to reach Britain, where they believe they'll have better job prospects. France has also summoned the U.S. ambassador to the foreign ministry following revelations by WikiLeaks that the U.S. National Security Agency eavesdropped on the past three French presidents. French President Francois Hollande describes this as an unacceptable security breach. The disclosures, which emerged late Tuesday, mean France has joined Germany on the list of U.S. allies targeted by the NSA. That release has prompted uproar among French politicians. South Korean President Park Jong-hai met officials from the U.S. Center for Disease Control and the World Health Organization today, discussing the Middle East respiratory syndrome outbreak in South Korea. Officials discussed ways to cope with this deadly outbreak, which has killed 27 people so far and sickened 179 in the country. More than 3,000 people are in isolation for possible MERS infection. Most of the fatalities in South Korea have been people with existing medical conditions, such as respiratory problems or cancer. And Britain's Queen Elizabeth II met with Germany's president in Berlin today on the first official stop of her three-day state visit to the country. The 89-year-old monarch and her husband, Prince Philip, were greeted at Berlin's Bellevue Palace by President Joachim Gauck. Germany's head of state is partner Daniela Schott. On entering the residence, they signed a guest book before going back outside and shaking hands with dignitaries and others lined up to meet them. Elizabeth then strolled across the grounds with Gauck for a formal greeting by a military honor guard and band that played God Save the Queen, as well as the German national anthem. Elizabeth met German Chancellor Angela Merkel later in the day after a boat trip along the River Spree. Coming up later, Brian Bush joins us with Moments in the Holy Land. But up next, author and speaker Dr. Linda Mintle joins us to discuss how to build and maintain healthy relationships. We're right back with more Harvest after this.
Many Christian ministries have desired to bring the gospel of Jesus to Israel, to proclaim his message of God's love to the villages and streets he walked while on this earth. Yet only one Christian network has been broadcasting the message of God's love to Israel for more than 10 years. By God's grace, LeSEA Broadcasting has been bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ and the voices of many American ministries to every home in Israel via Middle East television. You can help this great work by becoming a partner in faith for as little as $25 a month. Call today.
The World Pulse Festival is coming up on Friday, July 10th and Saturday, July 11th at the Compton Family Ice Arena. You're all invited. It's a free ticket event. And you're going to love the artist lineup. Friday, it's Vertical Church Band, Amy Grant, and Michael W. Smith. Saturday's lineup, it's Blanca, Sidewalk Prophets, 10th Avenue North, and you might remember this next band from last year, Building 429. It's not about me, and you're all there will be. Don't forget your free tickets. Don't forget about pre-parking. You can get your passes at worldpulsefestival.com. So we'll see you July 10th and 11th at the World Pulse Festival at Compton Family Ice Arena in South Bend, Indiana. Don't forget, free ticket info at worldpulsefestival.com.
Nepal earthquake victims need our help immediately. Feed the Hungry is providing critical food supplies to families suffering from the devastating 7.8 earthquake that has struck Nepal. The tragedy has caused widespread destruction in one of the world's poorest nations. The suffering is unimaginable, and we must respond now. We need your help now to purchase critical food and emergency supplies like rice, lentils, and blankets for thousands living and sleeping out in the cold. Please give generously and help us reach survivors in Nepal with compassion of Christ. They desperately need your help right now. Your gift of $60 will provide a month of food and emergency supplies to a surviving family in Nepal. $120 will give 10 survivors the life-saving aid they need. $600 empowers our local church partners in Nepal to help 50 earthquake victims who are struggling to survive. Thank you for helping us reach them today.
If you're like me, and really if you are, seek professional help. But if you're like me, you want to avoid conflict like the Lifetime Channel. Dr. Linda Mintle is not like me. She thanks God for that every day, I'm sure. She says you can build healthier relationships through conflict, and she writes about it in her book, We Need to Talk. She came to the right place, apparently. Linda, I hear the word conflict, and I bristle. You hear the word conflict, and you say, charge in.
Let's go.
And
yeah.
I say, ooh, huh, what?
So, but what do most people, when they hear the four words, which is the title of the book, We Need to Talk, what do you think?
That's
you
a
go,
bad thing.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Most people don't go, great, this is going to be exciting. Your boss says, we need to talk. You're not excited about going in for that conversation.
Right.
So I think your reaction is very typical of most people, which is why I felt like I needed to write about this, because conflict is really an important thing to be able to deal with well. It affects all of our relationships. It actually affects our spiritual relationship as well as our emotional relationships, our intimate relationships, and any relationship actually that we're in. If you can deal with conflict well, you're going to do better in life. So it's important.
Okay, so I need to be able to deal with conflict well. What's the first step to, I guess the first step towards that is not running away when conflict
right.
comes up, but that's very difficult for a lot of people to do.
It is. So the first thing you have to tell yourself is conflict is normal. So a lot of times people will ask me, is conflict a bad thing? Is my relationship bad if I'm having conflict? And I just go back to the very basics and say, conflict isn't good or bad, it just is. So when two people get together, we all come from different families, we come from different experiences, we have different ways of viewing things, naturally we're going to have some tension. And so that natural tension is all that conflict is. So if we can look at that as normal part of a relationship, that will really help. And I think it's interesting, there's a marital statistic that says that 69% of conflict in marriage never gets resolved.
Oof.
So we have a lot of conflict in our lives, and it's not so much whether or not it always gets resolved, although it's a good thing to try to resolve conflict, but it really is how you deal with that conflict that makes a big difference.
So you said when two people get together, they come with different perspectives.
Right.
So does that mean they have different styles or ways of dealing with conflict, and what are those styles?
They can. So what in the research, what we know is there's six basic styles that you can have as a conflict person. So you can be the avoider,
Thank you.
Is what you have. And you didn't even take, there's an assessment. There's a quick assessment. It's really fun on my website. You just go to my website, and there's a quick assessment, and it'll tell you your conflict style. But we don't even have to go for
no.
you because you're going to be an avoider,
right?
Right? So that's one. So one style is to avoid. Another style is to be very reactive and intense and passionate. Sometimes it's called a volatile style. So these are the people who, when you get into a conflict or an argument, the temperature rises, things start to get intense. Maybe there's some yelling. Maybe there's some intense words going on. But there's a lot of emotion around that. That tends to be the style that I was raised in and grew up with. Then there is the negotiator style, which is the one that everybody wants to be, which is more the calm, rational, let's just, you know, Chuck, let's just talk about that and see if we can work through our differences. So those are the three primary. And then in those, there's also a competitive style, which is the win-win. This is sort of like the athletic style where we've got to win at all costs,
right.
Which doesn't do well in relationships. It's great for athletics, but not so much for relationships. And there's an accommodating style where you're constantly giving in to the needs of others, which you can be viewed as a very nice person when you do that, but then you tend to build up resentment and feel like your needs are never getting met. And then the worst style, the absolute worst style, that if you have this style, you probably need to be in therapy with me. That is the hostile style, where you're blaming, you're yelling, you're screaming. It can even get to violence. We see a lot of intimate partner violence among people that have a hostile style, coming after you, accusing you, and that can be very, very destructive to relationships.
In a marriage, you probably, by the time you've been married long enough, maybe, you know, 6 minutes, you've figured out the other person's conflict style.
Right.
Certainly, when you're thrown into the workplace, it's not like you can choose the conflict styles
of
your coworkers. So how do you deal with people who have that different conflict style?
So that's a great point. So what you want to do is you want to figure out what yours is and then try to figure out what the person you're having to deal with is. And then you have to make some accommodations. So for instance, the real common one that people deal with is, especially in intimate relationships, is one person pursues and the other one distances. So you can imagine somebody going after, they want to talk, and the other person is moving away and says, I don't want to talk. Mm-hmm. So the person who's the avoider has to start saying, okay, is there some validity in doing this? And I'll give you two reasons why you have to move out of that avoidance style. One is that the research shows that if you avoid conflict, you have a shorter life.
Okay.
Okay, so if you want to live long, you need to be able to deal with conflict. So
there are days.
or not. So that's an important thing. So the avoider has to say, okay, I have to do this. I'm not going to get my needs met. I'm not going to be able to figure out how to problem solve things in life. I'm going to walk around. And what we don't want people to do is walk around with bitterness and anger and unforgiveness in their heart. And you just can't deal with those issues. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is why Matthew 18 is so important in Scripture, because it says, go to the person.
Yeah.
So one of the things I would argue is that avoidance is not a biblical style either. Because you have to go to a person if you have an offense. We talk about that in communion. When we do communion in the church, we talk about that just in healthy relationships. And Jesus was very specific about you go to a person when you have a conflict. The person who's kind of reactive and volatile, he has to calm down a little bit and take, and it's interesting because, again, you look at the research, when you're so worked up emotionally, and we actually have this fun thing we do in couples therapy where we put this little instrument on people's fingers, and each person in a couple wears it, and when you're in the middle of a conflict and you're getting so excited and so aroused, if your heartbeat goes over 100 beats a minute, you're too aroused, your brain begins to what we call flood, and you cannot think.
Wow.
And you don't listen to what's going on.
I have to think that that happens for most people within the first 5 seconds of the conflict.
Well, then people have to learn to calm down. So one of the things we teach people is when you're feeling that revved up feeling and you're so aroused and your heartbeat is going real fast and you're just feeling upset, you need to take a moment, you need to calm down, you need to maybe pray. That would be a great time. I always suggest that you pray before a conflict, but a lot of people, when they're in the middle of it and they get so upset, you could take a moment, you could begin to pray, do some deep breathing, and just calm yourself down so you can think in that conflict.
So what about the person, though, after that 5 seconds that you just talked about, but they're still, they walk away and they're so angry. I mean, they're still dealing with that anger that's deeply embedded because of that conflict. How do you handle that? I mean, what kind of kickstarts that forgiveness process?
Well, the anger is really, really important. And we know what Scripture says about that. It says, be angry. So it doesn't say you cannot be angry. Mm-hmm. Anger is an emotion. It's a God-given emotion. But it says, don't sin in your anger. So again, one of the things we know, when you hold on to anger at such an intense level and you don't begin to calm the body down, you're doing damage to the physical body. And so a lot of times anger is released by saying, okay, I'm upset about this. What's the root of that? They hurt me, they upset me, something terrible has happened. And that's where you have to look and say, is this one of those places where I need to begin to forgive? And, you know, you talked about, when you were talking at the beginning of the show about what was going on in Charleston, the most poignant thing for me was, I mean, you talk about a conflict, somebody coming in and doing what they did. The most poignant thing for me was at those bond hearings when those people, those Christian people went around the room and were saying, I choose to forgive you.
Absolutely.
What they did, and I listened to a lot of news commentators, and they didn't understand the power of forgiveness. But what happened there is, forgiveness is an individual act. It's not something you do together. Reconciliation is something that takes two people.
Right.
Forgiveness is individual. And when you forgive somebody, you are releasing all that negativity out of your body. And all that physical stuff that hurts the body actually depletes the immune system, does a whole lot of damage to the body. There's correlation between heart disease and hanging on to unforgiveness. So letting go and forgiving is not only a scriptural thing. And you do it first by choosing to forgive. And then the emotions a lot of time will follow. And again, the commentators didn't understand that. They said, how can those people, oh, they're in shock. They're in denial. And I thought, no, they understand the biblical power of saying, I choose to forgive. Now, their emotions will go all over the place. But as they release that, they're releasing all that negativity and that bitterness that could develop. And they're opening up their spiritual relationship with God, where God can really move and work and heal and do all the things he needs to do, in addition to the relationships that they're having with other people. It's powerful.
It is awesome. We'll talk more about this when we come back with more with Dr. Linda Mintle here on Harvest.
If you are among the thousands who love the teaching of Lester Sumrall, then you should have the two-volume set of The Treasury of Lester Sumrall. Written in Dr. Sumrall's easy-to-understand style, you'll feel like you are getting a Bible school education. There are 732 individual readings, one for each day for two whole years. These beautiful devotionals will also make a wonderful gift for your friends, family, or even your pastor. Order yours today.
Do you sometimes wonder what life would be like if you had the energy to do those extra things you want to do but just can't? Maybe it's to go for a walk after dinner or spend your Saturdays playing with your kids. If you're tired all the time and have decided that you just always will be, guess what? You don't have to be. With Mineral Concentrate from Making Healthy Choices, this fulvic acid electrolyte mineral formula promotes maximum cell function while sparking your body's electrical conductivity. What does that mean? Well, most people say they've never felt better. The best part is it's only $29.95. And if you call now, we'll even pay to ship it to you. So dial 1-800-965-2345 or go to mhclife.com. This electrolyte formula promotes dependable, solid energy day in and day out. So call the number on the screen. Do it for your spouse, your kids, your friends, and most of all, do it for you. Call 1-800-965-2345 or go to mhclife.com. It's time for life.
We're talking with Dr. Linda Mintle. She's the author of We Need to Talk. And going into the break, Linda, we were talking about forgiveness. And I think you made a point during the commercial that, that bears repeating. Forgiveness is not justification.
Right.
And we were talking, using the example of the people in Charleston, but I think you can probably come up with a myriad of family issues where you can forgive somebody, but that doesn't mean that there shouldn't still be some sort of consequences or some sort of relationship building after that forgiveness occurs.
That's right. You can think of something like where there's been an affair in a relationship, or maybe there's been abuse, some kind of abuse. A lot of people who are watching us have dealt with alcoholism in their family or addiction or some kind of serious problem that has had serious consequences. When you forgive someone, you are not condoning the behavior. You're not minimizing the effect of that behavior. And you're certainly not saying that what you did was okay. What you're saying is, because it wasn't okay. So see, that's the power of it. It's giving up. There's a very famous therapist who says forgiveness is giving up your right to actually be angry and upset. So you're saying, I have a right here because something unjust happened to me, but I choose to forgive that and to move on in the relationship. And then the consequences of those things do bear out. I mean, they do. So when you've, for, let's say you've had an affair, you have to build trust back into a relationship. And a lot of times that takes a lot of time. Mm-hmm. Or you have to work on proving to the person that your yes is yes and your no is no. And you're going to show up. You're going to do the things that you need to do. So that's the thing that gets people stuck in forgiveness, is they think it somehow is the same as reconciliation. Mm-hmm. And it's not. Because you can forgive someone and never reconcile.
Sure.
Especially if the person is very unsafe. You may not be able to have a reconciled relationship with that person.
So if the conflict is in the home, I mean, we talk about workplace conflict, but it's in the home. Let's say it's spouse, child, whatever. What steps do you need to take to be able to work with that? Because that may be a little bit different because you're with them every day.
Yeah.
And that's a different dynamic.
Right. So the first step is that trust. So looking at, do we have trust in this relationship? Because it's very hard to talk about difficult things if there isn't a sense of safety. Mm-hmm. And so how do you build that as a parent? Well, you follow through with your word. You do what you say. You enforce consequences. You build that security and that stability in the home. So you have to have some type of trust in a relationship. When you do that, you have to bring up the issue, right? Mm-hmm. So that's the first step. And again, the first step actually should be to always pray before you deal with something that's difficult, especially in your home where you have control over that.
Mm-hmm.
So pray with the person first. Then you need to bring up the issue and you need to make the move. So I hear a lot of people going, well, you know, my daughter hurt me. I'm not talking to her. Or, you know, my husband, he's the one who's a problem. When he comes to me, then we'll deal with the issue.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I have a line I use in therapy where I say only children fight about who goes first. So if you've had a conflict, you go to that person. Again, that's biblical. Go to that person. Don't wait. Make the move.
Right.
And then you always need to take responsibility for your part. So one of the issues is in any conflict, if I'm having a conflict with you, something I'm doing is probably impeding our ability to resolve that too. Maybe I didn't breach the problem. Maybe I wasn't the person who did something terrible, but maybe I'm not listening. Maybe I'm being defensive. The issue in conflict is whether or not it escalates. So what we know about any healthy relationship, if you can deal with conflict and not escalate it, and we know the escalation pattern. So here's what's important for people to know. If it starts with criticism, and again, this goes against scripture because scripture says a soft word. Scripture talks about a gentle start.
Right.
That's in the marital research,
right.
A gentle startup. You start gentle. But when there's a lot of criticism, if we start a conflict and I'm criticizing you, then all that happens is you get defensive.
Mm-hmm.
So then we have criticism and defensiveness. And then things start to escalate. And then there's what we call contempt, where people are rolling their eyes, they're kind of mocking you.
Mm-hmm.
They start to get nasty in the things that they're saying, then they personally attack. And then what happens is a stone wall goes up.
Mm-hmm.
And you get emotionally distant. So we know this in terms of relationships going south. Criticism to defensiveness to contemptuous feelings to stonewalling. When that happens, relationships become disasters rather than masters in relationships.
Now, I can see that in a lot of normal family conflicts, but you've brought up the words affair and abuse.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sitting here thinking that prayer line gets flooded with those kind of calls.
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm sitting there and let's say I was the victim of the affair, you know, you're the spouse who went off and slept with somebody else. It's going to be really tough for me to approach that without criticizing or being somewhat contemptuous when I approach you. How does that person approach in that conflict?
Well, you have to think if you're going to approach with an angry blaming, the person is not going to hear you because what happens is what we were talking about before. Your emotional state gets so aroused that you can't hear what that person is saying. So as difficult as it is, you can make complaints.
Mm-hmm.
You can, in relationships, say, here's what happened, here's how it hurt me, this is how it affected me, and this is very serious. So that's different than you're an idiot or why did you do that or I can't believe, you know, coming at pointing the finger. Again, it takes it up into that escalation range where nobody listens and nothing gets solved. So coming at the person, and this is where we need to learn to be assertive and use good I statements of here's what happened, this is how it impacted me, here's a serious problem, we need to deal with it. And then in the case of abuse, which is, again, what things that you're hearing on your prayer lines, sometimes you just have to set boundaries and say, When I'm in the room, I will walk out when that happens, or I will not listen to you when you're talking to me like that. And you have to set some appropriate boundaries on the way you have to relate to each other in the process, and that doesn't always happen.
Well, we're going to have Linda back on a future episode of Harvest so that we can talk more about these situations. But if you want to connect with Dr. Linda Mintle, go to drlindamintle.com. That's pretty simple. Or you can go to harvest-tv.com for a link to her book, We Need to Talk. Still to come, Pastor Mark will have today's connections. But up next, Brian Bush has his moments in the Holy Land. Don't go anywhere. There is more Harvest after this.
Did you know that millions live in spiritual darkness seeking the Word of God? LeSEA Broadcasting is piercing the darkness 24 hours a day. The window of opportunity to reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ has never been greater, but who knows when it will close. Join Partners in Faith today for as little as $25 a month, and you can help us bring light into a dark world. Join us by visiting partnerinfaith.com today.
Would you like to have a secure source of income for the rest of your life? What if that income was set and would never change no matter what the economy does? And at the same time, what if you knew you were changing lives for Jesus? That's right, it's a charitable gift annuity, the amazing part investment, part gift that never stops giving. The rates are much higher than savings accounts or certificates of deposit. It's the perfect way to honor God with your finances and fulfill the Great Commission. If you are over 49 and a half years old and you have at least $10,000, you may qualify. Call us at 1-866-224-2087 or go online to giftplanning@lesea.com. This hard-to-believe opportunity may not always be available, so call now while the rates of return are still high. Do it today, won't you?
Hello, everyone. Thanks for watching The Harvest Show. I'm Brian Bush, and we hope that we are helping you focus your day on God and the things of God. We are continuing now our series on service. And last time we spoke together, we talked about how we are made to do God's will, and He is faithful to use us for His glory. And the reward for that is seeing Him one day in a sinless, recreated world. I can't wait. Today, I wish to speak about seeking significance, because that's a real distractor to service. You see, man's original sin was disobedience. Man wanted to be the one in charge. And that, simply put, is elevating self. Because of our sinful state, we are full of pride, envy, and selfishness, all of which run completely contrary to God's demonstrated will for us, where we were made to serve Him. A good example, and the reason why I am standing out here in the hot, arid, dusty environment of the Judean hills, is because I want to connect the character of John the Baptist and the seeking of significance. Friends, John the Baptist was a popular guy. He was an immense preacher. He was the last prophet in the Old Testament era, and people came from all over To hear him preach, to hear that man was to be moved. And ultimately, one of the things that he said got him into a lot of trouble, because he said, ultimately, I must decrease, and he, that is to say Jesus Christ, must increase. John wound up losing his life because he stood up for God's laws in creation. Now, isn't that a lesson for us today in our society? But my point is this, that we as Christians need to have a demonstrated difference in that we do, that we speak, and the way we live our lives. It's got to be different than the world. Everyone in this life chases after something: wealth, fame, power, and those are all associated with sin. Don't waste your life in this world on things that will perish. Store up treasures in heaven and seek significance through service. Jesus said that the one who is greatest is the one who serves. Many of you know that my dad passed away recently, so I've been thinking obviously a lot about that. And I am asking the tough question to myself and to you: when your life is over, when my life is over, do we want to know that our lives mattered? Then you must serve. Serving is the primary method God uses to form the character of Jesus within us. When we serve, we become more like him. Remember the biblical verse: the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Hallelujah. Friends, join me again next time as we conclude our series on service and ask the question, what is then the key to a life of service? Bye-bye now.
Dr. Lester Sumrall was given a global vision to reach a million souls every day for Jesus Christ. To fulfill his God-given assignment, he began establishing the many outreaches of LeSEA Broadcasting. Today, the ministry reaches millions of people in more than 190 nations through the power of television, radio, free Bibles, shortwave satellite, and prayer line. But we need your help to reach millions more. Will you join Partners in Faith and help us spread the gospel around the world? Will you commit to giving a monthly gift of $25, $50, $100 or more? Dr. Sumrall knew he couldn't fulfill his vision without the help of thousands of partners. But don't wait. Become a partner in faith today. Call 1-800-365-3732 or visit LeSEA.com to give safe and secure online. The Bible says he who wins souls is wise. Make the wise choice today to become a partner in faith and help us win souls for Jesus.
I'm excited to have a conversation with you for the next 2 days about what I'm calling living in the world of supernatural knowledge. Now, I know most people, they want to increase their level of knowledge, which is why they may go back to school to earn a degree, or they may take a class so they can learn a new skill, may pick up a book to read so they can become better informed on that topic. And all of that's good, but it's even more important that you and I desire to increase our level of knowledge in the realm of the supernatural. And the reason that's important is because we cannot let our knowledge be tied to things as they are in the natural. The Bible teaches us in 2 Corinthians 4 and 18, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. You see, if our knowledge is tied only to the things which are seen, then we are limiting our perspective, limiting our knowledge. So many people are limiting who they can become in life, or maybe what they can do, because their knowledge is tied to that which they see. And I believe God is here this morning to take us out of that temporal world, expand our knowledge into the world of the supernatural. Because there's things that you don't yet know about yourself that you need to know so that you can grow, so that you can reach your potential in God. But the things you need to know will never be learned in the realm of the natural. Because take a look at this. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, he said, "The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, neither can he know them." Why? Because they are spiritually discerned. Now, we live our lives according to what we know. And what we know is generally based upon what we have experienced. The things that I do in life, the things that I don't do, what they are, they're according to the knowledge that I have accumulated through the experiences of life. So here's my question to you. What would happen if you increase the level of your knowledge into the realm of the supernatural? What would happen? You would begin to do, you would begin to not do things as a result of that increased level of knowledge. Take, for example, Peter, when he's in the boat with the other disciples on the Sea of Galilee. They see Jesus come walking on the water. Suddenly, everything Peter has been taught about water, and being a substance that does not have the ability to hold you, all of a sudden, that now has been suspended. The reality of what he knew in the natural was suspended. And he took the natural law of gravity, he submitted it to the supernatural law of grace, and as a result of that, listen to what Peter said. He said, Matthew 14 and verse 28, he said, "Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come to thee on the water." He said, "Come." And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Think of this. Peter had never seen anyone step out of the boat and walk on water before. He had never seen a human being do what Jesus was doing. But he knew by seeing Jesus that the same supernatural power that allowed him to walk on the surface that was humanly impossible to walk on would now allow Peter to do the same things. Friend, God is calling you to do some things in life for which you have no point of human reference. You've never seen anybody else do it before, but there's something inside of you that is telling you that there is a supernatural supply. There is a reservoir of knowledge that is available to you that will allow you to do something that you've never thought that you could do. And I believe that it's time for you and I to tap into that boundless reservoir of the knowledge of God, the supernatural knowledge, because God has unlimited knowledge. And he wants to drop a portion of that knowledge into your spirit. There's no boundary, no limit to the knowledge that God has. The disciples looked at Jesus in John 21 and said, "Lord, you know all things." Colossians 2 and verse 3 said, "In whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." And God will at times dip into that vast reservoir of knowledge and give you a word, a portion of that knowledge at just the right moment in your life. And you may be at that point right now. And I believe if you will allow God to give you that word that comes from the realm of the supernatural, you will have an understanding about where you are to go from this point, what you are to do from this point in life. And I want you to join me tomorrow. We're going to continue this conversation about living in the world of the supernatural. And right now, if you need prayer, there are prayer counselors standing by. Chuck and Pastor Charles are in prayer line talking about the power of the supernatural in your life that comes through prayer.
No question, Pastor Mark, there is a power of prayer that most people, quite frankly, don't understand and probably don't tap into enough. Dr. Summerall wrote plenty of books about prayer, and he said one of the big obstacles in prayer is simply not praying enough.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And Jesus made it perfectly clear. He told us very simply to always pray.
Yeah. And then there are also other things that we need to do in our life to kind of clear some of the obstacles to prayer. Mm-hmm. But certainly, we want to come into agreement with you. We encourage you to call us at 1-800-365-3732 or send your prayers in by email at prayer@lesea.com. And we were talking earlier in the show about relationships. And so many people call in here talking about broken relationships in their lives. And I imagine that's one of the biggest things that you wind up praying about.
Yeah, Chuck. Oldest trick in the book, divide and conquer.
Right.
You know, and so what the enemy does is he comes into the homes, and you know, that's the foundation of really preaching the gospel, is getting the home right. You know, so we got some here, Chuck, like Anita up in Canada. Anita calls in and says, I am in Canada and I watch the Harvest Show.
Well, God bless you.
And my marriage is in trouble, and maybe the example being shown to our daughter as well. She says, please pray that my husband returns home. And then we have Janie in North Carolina. Janie says, things are not going well with my marriage, and starting with the conversation, I ended in adultery. She says, please pray with me to get it right with my husband and be delivered from this. And then Irene in Wyoming says, I am divorced and yet having trouble with my ex. Please pray for my protection. He tried to run me down with his car. Well, and then Carrie in Indiana, Carrie says that we are a good family together, even with my ex living apart from us. Our daughter had a great relationship with him, and the other day he passed. She says, please pray that she grieves and presses on.
Well, Pastor, we're having a little problem with your mic today, but I think most of the people picked up on that. But tell you what, I'll pray for the people today. And Heavenly Father, we just ask that you take into account all of these situations, Lord. We know that you are in control of all of these situations. We know that you can handle all of them because you are a great and powerful God. We ask that you give these people the courage that they need to handle the conflicts in their lives, to approach them as you would approach them, Lord. Help them come to these conflicts with your spirit so that they can reconcile the situation, so that they can forgive where forgiveness needs to be done. We ask mainly, Lord, that you just watch over and protect these people and bless them in your holy name. Amen. A reminder, 1-800-365-3732 is the number that gets you in here. Also, prayer@lesea.com, and we accept mail, just not bills, at 61300 Ironwood Road, South Bend, Indiana, 46614. The Harvest Show continues after this.
Jesus said, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Do you have some treasures like silver and gold coins or old jewelry that you don't wear anymore? Why not invest them into changing lives for Jesus? Ask yourself if these treasures are really worth keeping, or should you invest them into making an eternal difference in someone's life? Call 1-800-365-3732 for a prepaid insured shipping envelope. Lay up your treasure in heaven. It'll be waiting for you when you get there.
The Lord bless you and keep you.
May his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you.
The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace.
And may the Lord place his name upon you.
May the Lord bless you indeed and enlarge your border. May his hand of might be with you.
May the Lord keep you from danger, prosper you, and give you hope.
May the peace of God guard your heart and your mind in Christ.
By his stripes you are healed.
Dr. Lester Summerall said that faith comes not by prayer, but by continually feeding on God's Word. Paul the Apostle wrote that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. LeSEA Broadcasting's Partner in Faith make it possible for millions to hear the Word of God in over 190 countries, whether by television, shortwave radio, free Bible distribution, a 24-hour daily prayer line. Souls hear the gospel. Will you join our fellowship of partners in faith? With every soul you reach for Jesus Christ, you're laying up treasure in heaven. We need your help to reach the lost for Jesus Christ. You can be a partner in faith for as little as a monthly gift of $25. Call 1-800-365-3732 and tell the prayer operator you want to be a partner in faith. Call today, 1-800-365-3732. Live from Studio B.
Even when the rain falls, even when the flood starts rising,
Jesus, so I shine your peace on earth.
For the very best in Christian music, be sure to watch Live from Studio B each week on this LeSEA broadcasting station.
A reminder, we are undertaking a project this summer called the Global Summer Harvest, trying to reach more of the untold billions yet untold. We have a number of ministries throughout LeSEA Broadcasting that do that. They are considered unfunded ministries. In other words, they don't pay for themselves. We need your help to pay for them. Things like the Spread the Word Bible campaign that have sent almost 750,000 Bibles worldwide, shortwave radio, Middle East television, and Pastor Mark Lantz, as we look at all these different aspects of LeSEA Broadcasting, they remind me very much of the Great Commission mm-hmm. that we're all given. And I frequently encourage people that, you know, when that Great Commission was given to the disciples, mm-hmm. it wasn't just given to them, it was really given to all of us, wasn't it?
Absolutely. And Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. And I know most of us cannot go into all the world, but LeSEA Broadcasting is. So when you partner with LeSEA Broadcasting, Middle East Television, Spread the Word, literally, you're going into all the world and preaching the gospel, spreading the gospel, and we're fulfilling the Great Commission every single day by those avenues.
It's amazing the technology that we have at our disposal here, the great shortwave technology, which, you know, a lot of places don't have the opportunity to use, or maybe they think it's an old-fashioned technology. Quite frankly, it's a very expensive technology. Mm-hmm. It requires a lot of electricity, but the impact that it can have, I don't think it can be fully measured.
You're reaching people that would never hear the gospel otherwise. Yeah. They don't have access to other media or other means. Shortwave is the way that they get the gospel, and what a great way to spread the word.
Especially in these days where there's so much on the internet, and a lot of us in the United States take for granted that, well, everybody must have the internet because it seems like everybody here has it. Mm-hmm. And that's certainly not the case worldwide. There's not really good internet service in most countries, or governments jam the internet and block it. But they aren't always able to do that with shortwave radio. They're certainly not able to do that with the Spread the Word campaign, as we've been able to send those Bibles into 190 countries. So you've got a chance to make a difference in somebody's life. Dial it up, 1-800-365-3732, or go online at lesea.com. See you tomorrow here on Harvest.
Pete Summerall has always shared his father's lifelong vision to save the lost. So over the summer months of June and July, LeSEA Broadcasting is praying fervently that God will bring in a bountiful global summer harvest. To sustain vital ministries that are now reaching countless millions of people, LeSEA must receive $331,000 in the next 60 days. Please send your June gift today. To send your June gift today, visit LeSEA Broadcasting online at lesea.com. LeSEA.com.
Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life.
The Harvest Show is produced by LeSEA Broadcasting and is viewer supported by people just like you. Thank you for inviting us into your home today.